Good morning, everybody. I'm really honored to be in front of such a distinguished group of experts on this really important issue. And first, I want to give my thanks to Steve and all the coaches folks, and also to the Public Welfare Foundation, Langeloth, the Open Society Foundation, Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, and also the federal partners, Department of Justice, SAMHSA, ONDCP, for your support of us and many others in this room and outside, your leadership and your farsightedness in seeing the opportunities that really are enormous and are out there but are not always so obvious. I'm also going to thank some people in New York for reasons that will become clear as I launch into what I'm up here to talk about, which is to talk about what's happening in New York State as a case study for how to try to start moving forward to take advantage of some of these enormous opportunities that we've been hearing about all morning. In 2012, the two deputy secretaries in New York State, in the governor's office, one for public health and one for public safety, asked us at the Legal Action Center to co-lead with the New York State Department of Health a project to develop linkages between the criminal justice system and the healthcare system with a special emphasis on health homes. And let me just start by leading up back to that. Well, how did we get there in two important pieces of background? One of them is, what is a health home? There's a lot of people think it's an actual place. It's actually not. It's a network of healthcare services. It was created under the ACA as a Medicaid initiative to try to address the needs of people who are high utilizers of Medicaid because they're high utilizers of the healthcare system because they have multiple chronic illnesses. So people with addiction, people with serious mental illness, people with HIV, people with other chronic conditions like diabetes and asthma, and a couple of others are eligible for health home services. And the federal government, for the first 2 years, when a state launches a health home, pays for most of the care, most of the coordination of the care provided by the health home. But then on an ongoing basis, as we know, the ACA, under the ACA, many of the people who will be in the health homes will be part of the Medicaid expansion, and the federal government will be paying for all of that in many expansion states, and then it goes down over time to still paying a huge percentage. Most of the funding will come from the federal government. So it's a huge opportunity to try to address the chronic conditions that many people have. And then secondly, how did New York come to the conclusion of, well, we want to focus on moving the criminal justice system and the healthcare systems together, including with an emphasis on the health home initiative possibilities? Well, it came about because both deputy secretaries really saw the opportunities, even as the deputy secretary for public safety, for criminal justice, said to us, you need to know, I don't know anything or about very much about Medicaid. But Liz Glazer, the deputy secretary, was willing to try to learn all about that and try to figure out what the opportunities seemed great, but without understanding the details, she didn't know how to take advantage of that. And also, the Deputy Secretary for Public Health, Jim Mintrone, told us, this sounds very exciting, but you gotta know, I don't know really anything about the criminal justice system. So that, in a nutshell, is both the challenge that we face, but also the opportunity. Because when the two of them were willing to say, I don't know about the other system, but I realize I should, and there are huge opportunities, and let's work together, that's where the opportunity really arises. There's another really important ingredient, which I know will come as a huge surprise to you, and that's money. For some reason, money really also helped engage and actually some of the reasons for that, though, were not immediately apparent, because for people who do not understand both systems and how they fit together and how the financing of both systems work and potentially could help each other, none of this is not only not obvious, but it's not even going to be, you know, it can't even be grasped. So one of the ways that we engaged was to start in on what are the immediate financial opportunities here for the state. And New York State was in, at that point, not anymore, but 2 years ago, was in a fairly unique situation, because New York State was one of the states that was already suspending, not terminating, Medicaid for people in prison. And also, New York State was one of the few that had been providing Medicaid through a waiver to the childless adult population at a higher level of income than, at that point, the federal guidelines were. So New York, in other words, was already working with a large part, was already providing Medicaid and working with the healthcare needs through Medicaid of a large part of the population that is now the ACA Medicaid expansion population. So New York already had the ability to address that population through Medicaid. So we and a few others helped the state understand that even under the current Medicaid rules, this was not something that came from the ACA, that while federal Medicaid will not, of course, pay for health care provided to someone who is incarcerated in the jail or prison, if someone needs to go out, someone who's incarcerated needs to go outside of the jail or prison and receive institutional care for over 24 hours in a hospital or nursing home or several other facilities, federal Medicaid will pay for that. So now New York State realized our prison system, we've got a lot of people who are eligible for Medicaid, and we're already dealing with them through the waiver. And we've got a lot of people going outside for health care outside our state prisons. And in fact, when they ran the numbers, they found that they were spending over $60 million a year on that type of health care. So that with the federal match, if people were on Medicaid, you know, that's a lot of money. So there is a huge financial incentive there. And as a result, New York State 2 years ago began the process of enrolling everyone who was eligible for Medicaid who didn't come into the prison on Medicaid, enrolling them on Medicaid while they are incarcerated. That will obviously help enormously as people come out of prison because they'll have their Medicaid card when they leave prison, but it will also be saving the state a lot of money in the way I just described while they're incarcerated. And these benefits are there, these financial incentives are there, not just in the prisons, but also for the jails. So really, every state and locality in the country has the opportunity now to really benefit financially in the ways I've just described. So given all that, both deputy secretaries decided to do this, sent the word down to all of the healthcare and criminal justice agencies in the state saying that we want you to participate. So as a result, we're now running a work group for the Department of Health that consists of over 40. We have a party that keeps growing because people want to join. We're now over 40 state, city, and county agencies. And also, it includes also advocates and service providers. And the reason to focus on the health homes, that in part, was that the state realized that the population of people who are eligible for health homes, which is the chronic people with multiple chronic diseases, as I mentioned, has a lot of overlap with the criminal justice population. As we know and that we've heard, a lot of people in the criminal justice system have multiple chronic conditions. And in fact, kudos not just to New York State, but also to New York City, because the city has really been playing a pioneering role both in their criminal justice system at Rikers and probation and elsewhere, Rikers Island, the jail, as well as in the healthcare system and the city health and mental health departments. So one of the things that happened early on in all of this is that the city did a match and they looked at over 2,000 people incarcerated in jail at Rikers Island and found that 50% of them met the criteria for a health home. So the state and the city, realizing that this is a real opportunity to get a lot of people into care, manage their care, and by the way, it's mostly paid for by the federal government. So what we're doing now going forward is that through that work group over a year ago, we decided that the way to start was to identify some health homes that were willing to be pioneers in figuring out how to engage the criminal justice population. There are a lot of challenges, which I'll talk about in a minute. So we knew that it needed to be health homes that had some knowledge and experience, but even some ways more important, were willing to take this challenge on and willing to try to work through the difficulties. And we chose six health homes to be pilots in working through how to do this very difficult but important work of engaging the criminal justice population. There are two in Brooklyn, two in the Bronx, and two in upstate New York, in western New York. We also set up a number of subcommittees to try to lay the groundwork so that these pilots can work. And we looked at a number of the basic infrastructure and technical issues we needed to put together to make this work. So we have an operations subcommittee that's figuring out what are the key challenges and the key barriers and what are the solutions, and those will become the main focus of these pilots as they move forward to try to work on those issues, solve them in ways that can be replicated. We also want to study and evaluate the effectiveness of these pilots and study both the healthcare metrics, which are already in place for the health homes in New York State, but also, very excitingly, if that's a word, also look at a couple of key criminal justice metrics. So we're going to be looking at, for people who come from the criminal justice system and go into health homes, what are the reincarceration rates compared to the norm, and also we'll be looking at what are the rearrest and or reconviction rates, and that's still being worked out, exactly what the metrics will be. But so it'll be very exciting to be able to measure both. But clearly, to make this work, there we need to have into place the ability to track and make sure that it's the same person who in the criminal justice system and in the healthcare system outcomes. And that's proving to be a significant challenge, because it requires matching the state's Medicaid number with the state New York State identification number for the criminal justice system. So now the state agencies, the Division of Criminal Justice Services, and the Department of Health have their technical people there working together to try to figure out how those numbers can be matched on an ongoing basis so that we can study what happens in both systems to the same person with confidence that it actually is the same person. There also are issues related to, just to give you a sense of some of the kind of technical issues that come up. The criteria for health homes are based largely on prior Medicaid use. And of course, that makes sense because we're looking at people with chronic conditions who are utilizing Medicaid a lot. So that would make sense. Except if you think about the incarcerated population, when they're incarcerated, for the most part, they don't have any Medicaid use at all. So under their current criteria, they wouldn't be eligible for a health home. So we're going to work through and figure out how to do that. And one other thing to mention before I wrap up with what are some of the other key challenges we're looking at is that what we're realizing in this work also is that while much of the focus is on health homes, what we're developing really will be translatable to all connections between the criminal justice system and healthcare. There are a couple of them, as I've mentioned, that are specific to health homes, but in terms of figuring out how to get people enrolled and how to link them to care and how to work through these barriers, it really doesn't matter whether people are going to a health home or they're going to any other part of the healthcare system. So what we're developing hopefully will be very useful across the board. And in that regard, one other issue that we're now looking at is there are issues that come up when a court or other part of the criminal justice system mandates a certain type of care, but the healthcare system, the managed care company, whatever, doesn't think that's the appropriate care. So how do the systems work together in that way? New York State is one of the only, and maybe the only state, that has a requirement that that managed care insurance companies honor any court mandates. In some other states, we've heard that that insurance or managed care may not be honoring court mandates. And that can become about either because maybe the people don't want to pay, or there may be some questions about whether the referral is correct. So that's another really important issue to work with. And we've also, so the pilots are off the ground, they're starting to work. I've talked about incarceration and jails and prisons, but we're also very focused on trying to have this work as early in the criminal justice system as possible, to work with the courts, to work with drug courts and other courts, to work with probation, to try to have have this start to link even at booking. Our goal being that the earlier the better. If people don't have to be incarcerated, that's great. If they don't even have to be prosecuted, that's even better for people who are appropriate. So we're looking at trying to work that through. There's a couple of other issues that we're really getting into the nitty-gritty. And just to give you a couple other important ones, one is for the state prison system, the mechanics of enrolling people who are in prison in Medicaid is a challenge. New York, like many states, has a county-based Medicaid system, which means people enroll in Medicaid through their county. But people who are in prison are usually incarcerated in a different county than where they're from. And those counties don't want to spend the time and money and energy enrolling people in a prison when they don't live there. So after a long time of wrestling with this, what the state came up with is they put out an RFP to see which county in the state would want to take money from the state to enroll everyone in the state prison. And a number of them applied, and Clinton County in upstate New York is now enrolling everybody in state prison. So, you know, an ingenious solution the state came up with, I think, to a difficult problem. Housing is a major issue. Linking people to the care they need. These are all the kinds of things we're going to need to work through. So let me just close on another high note about this, just to show the real commitment that New York State has made now, is that the state budget that just passed on April 1, there's been an agreement made that the state is going to allocate $5 million to support this pilot project on the health homes. So the state's really putting its money where its conviction is to start to move all of this forward. And hopefully soon we'll start to get some results that we can send around. Thanks very much. Am I dragging?